Just because Parliament passes a law does not make it right, and nor does it mean it will stay that way forever. And in the first 3 months after the same-sex marriage law came into effect earlier this year, only 1,400 same-sex weddings actually took place. Far less than the number of people who've left the Conservative Party over it, I'm sure. Many people who voted Conservative in 2010 feel so let down by Mr. Cameron over the issue that they have said they will never vote for his party again. Even Conservative MPs who firmly opposed the same-sex marriage bill have been told by constituents, I'm sorry, but despite the fact that you did that, I cannot vote for you again because I cannot vote for your party.
Hazelmary, a lot of people will know a bit about your story, the fact that you were sued for your policy of only giving double beds in your B&B to married couples, married opposite-sex couples. Well, let's just get a little bit of the background. How long have you and your husband, Peter, been involved in the hospitality industry?
Well, we had 10 years at a guest house in Redruth, and we've now had a total of almost 29 years at the hotel.
Your married couples only policy, that actually hit the headlines quite some time ago, I think in the 90s.
What was that about? We have always felt like that ever since we've let rooms. Now, in 1996, in a roundabout way, our local paper picked up the story and did a feature on us. And we had a huge amount of support. A lot of talk radio stations rang up and interviewed us and so on.
And this was to do with turning away unmarried heterosexual couples.
It was exactly the same thing. It was to do with unmarried heterosexual couples. You see, we hold this policy because we're interested in marriage, not anything else. We were there to defend marriage, which we've seen for years was under threat.
Now, when the Bristol County Court ruled that you had discriminated against Mr. Preddy and Mr. Hall, ordered you to pay £3,500. One of the things the judge said, of course, was he realised he was forcing you to go against your religious convictions. Yeah. Then there was the appeal. That was very high profile. How did it feel being in the midst of all that?
Nerve-wracking, obviously. We'd already suffered. By then, our business was in big trouble. The thing has been put to us, why don't we change careers? Well, why should we? It was what we were trained for. It's what we enjoy. You've only got my word for it, but we're actually good at it. And it just, that is not an argument.
So unfortunately, you lost your appeal, and then you went to the Supreme Court, and you were asking the Supreme Court for reasonable accommodation.
Yes.
And they said
no.
One of the five Supreme Court judges involved in your case was Baroness Hale. And after your case, she went on the lecture circuit and she started suggesting that maybe we should change the law to allow reasonable accommodation.
When I heard this, I felt that we were on the Supreme Court itinerary, on their bookings list, if you like, for about 20 months before we went to court. Why couldn't they have researched this and thought it through before we ever showed up?
Well, Hazelmary, thank you for your courage, for you and Peter. You're an inspiration, you know, to a lot of people.
Our national petition gathered 660,000 signatories of all faiths and none. So we're not a party political organisation. Parliament can change the law, but marriage remains, in reality, a union between one man and one woman. Now the Coalition for Marriage would like to repeal the law, and that's our aim, that's our goal. But in the meantime, there's all the mess of the change that has happened. There are the issues now of people who believe in traditional marriage being punished for their beliefs. I'm sure if you've noticed that free speech is being suffocated in our country, often by politically correct officials who want to tell us what to think. The law should be there to protect our freedoms, but it's not doing that job well enough. Now, we've heard this comment from the Deputy President of the Supreme Court, Lady Hale. She argued for a reasonable accommodation law. We must be campaigning for our liberties to be restored in the UK. True marriage is the greatest partnership in history. Time and again, the evidence shows the benefits of marriage for children. And for the sake of future generations, for the sake of freedom of speech and freedom of conscience, let's fight for the freedom to believe in real marriage. Thank you.
I'm here to talk to you today about one issue, the issue of freedom of conscience. I'm going to simply ask, what is fair? What is reasonable for the law to allow? And my argument is that if we oppose discrimination, then it is reasonable that neither should Christians be discriminated against if they hold traditional beliefs. They should not lose their jobs for doing so, or for refusing to do things which go against a deeply held conviction. It's one thing to say that it's not a crime to hold a particular opinion, but if the acting on that opinion provides legal consequences, in some ways it might as well be. The whole point about reasonable accommodation for conscience is that the word reasonable allows those unusual grey areas to be determined by the courts if necessary, but protecting individual freedoms. At the moment, it's that lack of protection for freedom which I have a problem with. Offence is something which does happen, and it can happen on both sides of any debate, on both sides of any argument. Some people do offend each other. Get over it.